To find out my dad needed hospice, there was all kinds of emotions. Miller Hospice wanted to start care immediately.
It was very hard, but it was a relief knowing that we weren't alone.
They treated him like he was the most important person in the world. They were like angels to our family and a miracle. They carried us through the hard times, and they carried my dad through the hard times. We were able to get through it with their help.
Hello, welcome to Calvary Baptist Church, where Scott L. Gordon is our pastor. We hope you enjoy today's message.
We'd like to invite you to come out on Sunday mornings at 11 a.m. and Wednesday nights at 6:30 p.m. Thank you.
My life is in His hands.
My life is in
church.
No matter what.
Trials and tribulations, church.
No matter what.
You just lost your job.
No matter what.
Your spouse done left. Your son is acting up.
No matter what.
Come on, Calvary, trust and believe it.
No matter what.
No matter what may come your way, church.
No matter.
Again, for allowing me to come into your living room. And then let me also say thanks to Miller Hospice for making this possible. And I hope you enjoy this message as we're getting ready for this morning's message. Get your Bibles and get ready. Once again, get ready for the word, for the manifestation to come into your life.
1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter. And I think that God knows how to set it up the way that he want to work it out. 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, the 18th verse. And it says, in everything. Y'all see that? Amen. Do I need to wait just a moment? Because I want you to see that. I want you to see that in the text. It says, in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Would you just look at your name and tell your neighbor, say, neighbor? Jesus expects a praise. Would you look at your other neighbor and tell your other neighbor, say, neighbor? Jesus expects a praise. I want to deal with that this morning because I just believe that somebody ought to know that Jesus expects your praise. Because your praise ought to be an expression of what God has done for you. So now if God has done anything for you, then you ought to already have a yet praise down on the inside. You should not have a problem with giving God praise for what he has brought you through. Is there anybody here that God has brought you through and brought you out and and made a way out of no way. I just came to serve notice today to summon that God expects a praise. Would you like to tell your neighbor, say neighbor? He expects a praise. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you that I may decrease so you can increase. Because God, you are worthy to be praised. And God, because you expect the praise, God, we're going to set the atmosphere to give you a praise. And we give you the praise, the glory, and the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible declares in 1 Thessalonians, the Bible declares the writer begins to write, and he says, in everything, give thanks. And so that means that in all that we go through, we ought to give God thanks. Anybody going through a bad time right now? I came to serve notice, you ought to thank him. Anybody going through a good time right now? You ought to thank him. Anybody got a bad report? You ought to thank him. Anybody broke? You ought to thank him. Anybody got all that you think that you need? You ought to thank him. Is there any thankful people in the house? You say, Reverend, if you only understood what I was going through, then you wouldn't be able to thank him. But the Bible says, let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. And so because I realize that all of us here have breath, then we ought not have a problem to give God some praise. And so the text goes on to say, for not only is it the command, but it says, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And then he also says, quench not the spirit. And so what happens is, when the atmosphere is set, we don't need the atmosphere to be quenched. So would you tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I don't need you to distract me, because I need to give God some praise for what God has done for me. So tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, if you got something to say to me, say it right now, because I didn't come here for you, I came here for God. Now don't be afraid to tell him. Say, neighbor, if you want to talk to me, you need to wait till after the preacher get done, because I came expecting a miracle, and because I came expecting a miracle, I don't need your distraction. I don't need you to quench what God is trying to do through me, for me. Give God a hand praise. And so Paul writes to the Thessalonians, and he says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. Quench not the spirit. Now, we have to understand that God expects our praise. Now, somebody would ask me, well, Reverend, you made that statement. Now, I need you to support that statement by scripture. If you would travel with me to Luke, the 17th chapter, Matthew, Mark, and then Luke. The writer Luke, the physician, writes, and he says, in Luke, the 17th chapter, beginning with the 11th verse. Can you get your Bibles and travel with me? Because Jesus expects your praise. And because he expects your praise, you ought not have a problem with praising him in your closet. You ought not have a problem with praising him on your job. And you surely should not have a problem when you come to God's house to give God some praise. When you come up on the parking lot, you ought to already come expecting to give God some praise in his house, because you came to see him, you ought to praise him. Anybody bring a sacrifice of praise this morning? And because I came to God's house, I came with the sacrifice of praise. So that means I don't care if you sing in every key, you don't have to hit my key, because I brought my own praise. Is there anybody that brought their own praise? And so the writer begins to say, look at what the writer begins to say. The writer says in Luke, the 17th chapter, and it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaritan and Galilee. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, there was a circumstance. And because there was a circumstance, Jesus came to the problem. Because some of y'all here today may have a problem, and you're trying to figure it out why God has already worked it out. And because of your circumstance, God knows how to meet you where you at in order to help you get to where you need to get to. Somebody say circumstance. And in verse number 12 says, and he entered into a certain village. Can I tell you that Jesus knows your address? Can I tell you that Jesus knows your job situation? Can I tell you that Jesus knows exactly where you're at right now? And because he knows where you're at, he knows how to meet you right where you're at. Is there anybody need God to meet you where you're at? And so I want to suggest to you this morning from the text that you can't hide from God. And you know what? That problem may seem too big for you, but even though the problem may be seem too big for you, God is bigger than your problem. Is there anybody believe that God is bigger than your problem? And because God is bigger than your problem, and God will meet you where you're at, and he knows your circumstance, then you ought to have a yet praise. But somebody say, well, Reverend, you don't understand what I'm going through. Well, let me tell you something, baby. I may not understand what you're going through, but I know somebody that'll take you through what you're going through. I know somebody that'll meet you exactly where you're at to help you get to where you need to be. Well, Reverend, the weight of the world is on my shoulder. Well, the Bible says, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. Jesus expects our praise. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, Jesus expects our praise. And then it's interesting, it's very interesting in the text that God always shows up, Brother Heath. He always shows up. And you know what, Brother Heath? He will use ordinary people like you and I to just show up to show that he cares and we count. And so the text says, and he entered into a certain village. There met him 10 men that were lepers. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, these were some sick folks. I know I ain't got no sick folks here this morning, but these were some sick folks. These were some outcasts. These were some people that could not fellowship with other people because of the disease that was on their body. And God knew exactly how to meet them, because I believe, Sister Carol, that somebody was crying all last night. I believe that somebody's going through a trial and a tribulation, and they need God to show up. Anybody need God to show up? Anybody really need God to show up? Somebody would say, Reverend, if you only knew what I was going through, then you're preaching directly to me, because I need God to show up. Can anybody be real with me? Is there anybody that need God to show up? And because I need him to show up. God, I don't need you to show up a minute late. I don't need you to show up an hour late. I need you to show up because I heard that you are an on-time God. And because I heard you were on time, I need you to show up. Anybody need God's help? Yeah. And then look at what 12 says. I'm going to walk through the text. And it says, and as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. So these men stood afar off, but they knew Jesus was coming into town. And they said, and they lifted up their voice. And let me tell you something. I believe. Somebody say, well, Reverend, it don't take all that. Reverend, you don't have to be so loud. Reverend, you ought to quiet down. But let me tell you something. When I think of the goodness and all that God has done for me, when I think of what he brought me through, danger seen and unseen, I just can't keep it to myself. When I realize that he woke me up this morning, when I realize that he's been good to me, when I realize that he was better to me than I've been to myself, I can't help but say thank you, because he's been good to me. I try and be good, but when I think of it, I can't help it, because it helps me to express how good God's been to me. Has God been good to anybody? And the Bible says, and they lifted up their voice. So I don't believe that they said Jesus. I don't believe they whispered it. I believe that they said Jesus. And the text says, look at the text. And they lifted up their voice and said, Jesus. Now, what did they say?
Jesus.
I don't believe they said it like you said it. The Bible said they lifted up their voice. Now, what did they say?
Jesus.
The text says they said,
Jesus.
And look at what they said. The Bible says that he met them in the village and they shouted,
Jesus.
And he says, Master, have mercy on me. And the text says, he said, us. So one thing I want to drop on the text is they were all on one accord. Oh, can I say that one more time? They were all on one accord. When we're on one accord, giving God praise, glory, and honor that he expects, God will show up, show out, and leave you his glory. Is there anybody here want God to show up, show out, and you want to see his glory? Anybody want to see the glory of God? And it says, look at what he says in the text in verse number 13. It says, and they lift up their voices and said unto him, Jesus. Somebody say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Now I believe that they called that name because they realized that there's power in that name. I believe they call that name because they realize it was deliverance in that name. I believe that they call that name because it was a name above all other names. I believe that they call that name because he's the Alpha and Omega. I believe they call that name because he's the beginning and the end. I believe they call that name because he's a comforter to them. I believe that they call that name also because he is a healer to him. Anybody know him as a healer? And then I believe that they call that name because that name is able to do anything but fail. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, there's power in that name. And then the text goes on to say, and it says, and to them, and when he saw them, he said unto them, go show yourself unto who? The priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were what? And so the text says that as they went, now he met them where they were at, but as they went, the problem that they had was already dismissed because they had faith to know that he was able. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, you have to walk by faith and not by sight. If you can believe it, you can achieve it. If you can believe it, then God will show up and make a way out of no way. And he tells them to present themselves to the temple priest. And not only that, their leprosy disappeared en route. So I believe that some of y'all woke up this morning and you had a problem, but because you were en route to the house of faith, that you left your problem at home. Can I make with the text? Some of y'all left your problem at home. But the problem is, your problem is still going to be there because of your expression of gratitude that you're giving him today because of the problem that you left behind. En route, you lost your problem, but on your way back, because of you not being grateful, you're going to go back to your same old problem. You say, Reverend, that's not in the text. Yes, it is in the text. Look at what he says. He says, and it came to pass that as they went, they were clean. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God. Now, if you take the text says that 10 of them came to God, but only one of them had the gratitude to come back to thank God. Now, I know all of us has been in a situation that God has brought us through, brought us out. But I believe the reason that we face some of our problem is because we don't have a praise for God for what he's done for us. Is there anybody that's grateful for what God has done for you? And now you got to understand this. You have a right to praise him. And let me give you a few reasons why you ought to praise him. You ought to automatically praise him because he woke you up this morning. And you say, well, Reverend, that's not good enough. Well, another reason is he woke you up another morning. And because he woke you up, you ought to have a praise down on the inside. And because he woke you up, you should not have a problem with telling God thank you. You know, when you were drunk and you didn't think you were going to make it and he brought you through that. You know, when you were on the other side of the track and he delivered you from all of those snares of the enemy, and you know that he cleansed you up, he made you whole, and now you ought to say, and the text says that, and one of them, when he saw that he was healed. And see, the problem is that we know God can do it, but we sit down on God. Can I say that one more time? We know God can do it. We know that God has done it, but Jesus expects our praise. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, Jesus expects our praise. The Bible declares that we're overcome by our what? Testimony. So a testimony is a test that God has brought us through, and if he brought us through a test, then we ought to have a testimony on how good God is. Now, my testimony is that I was sinking deep in sin, forward from the shore from sin, but love lifted me, because when I was down, Jesus met me, picked me up, turned me around, set my feet on solid ground. My testimony is I should have been dead and gone, but I thank the Lord that I am still alive. I thank him that he brought me through danger, seen and unseen. I thank him that he kept me when I could not even keep myself. So I don't have a problem with praising God. So now I want you to think about your testimony. Anybody got a test that God has brought you through? And now that he's brought you through, would you give him a praise for it? And then look what the text says. Because some of y'all just gave him a patty cake praise. That's all we did. You gave it to him because I asked you. But the text says, can I walk this text? The text says that the one that he cleansed, and it was 10 of them, Brother Mike, but the one that came back, Brother Mike, had a gratitude to say, Lord, I know I was an outcast back then, but God, you cleaned me up. And because you cleaned me up, I'm coming back to give you some praise, because I know that I couldn't have done it by myself. I know that if it had not been for the Lord on my side, then I would not have made it. So the text says in Luke, the 17th chapter, it says, and he fell down on his face. And the text says that, and he fell down on his face. And when he saw him, and fell down on his face at his feet and gave thanks, and he was a Samaritan. Now, there's some research in this text. Now, it's very funny that the outcast came to give God praise, when those in the house should have been the one that gave him praise. So what it said was that the Samaritan, the one that was a Gentile, came to give him praise. So now all of y'all are saved. God has brought you through danger, seen and unseen. You are all on the same winning team, but you act like you don't even got a praise. And because we're all on the winning team, I shouldn't even ask you to give him praise. When you came in, you ought to have a praise down on the inside. When you came in, you ought to already been able to wave your hand. Now, I know we have dressed this thing up. We've rehearsed it so much. So that means when the praise team get up, we are praise God. But I don't need a praise team to praise God. Huh? So that means if Sister Kelly don't hit the right key for you to get up, then that means you're not going to get up. But now my praise is not based on what they see. My praise is based on what he brought me through. Can I go on and preach the text? So that means that I got a praise already down on the inside. Now look at your neighbor, tell your neighbor, say neighbor. He's not meddling. But when he said that, you should have had a praise down on the inside. So now watch what happens here. Watch what happens here. Now the Bible says that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory. And so because of that, he's brought us from point A to point B. And so now the text says that this leper was healed, and on their way out, because I believe that some of us came to church today and we received a blessing and we shouted in the sanctuary and we gave him praise. And then many of us can come and get delivered. Y'all ever met somebody that was just so tore up from the floor up? They got saved, came and thanked God, paid tithes for a month, and you ain't seen them for 2 years. But that's the text. And then look what the text says. But the one. Do I just got one crazy praiser in the house? Let me ask that one more time. Do I just got one crazy praiser in the house? That you know that you got to praise because of what God has done for you. You know that God has brought you through dangers, seen and unseen. Because Jesus expects our praise. Then look what the text says. I really want to deal with that Samaritan for just a moment. Because that was an outsider that came. Can I tell you that there should not be anybody that can outpraise you for the blessings that God has done for you, especially of another religion or another. This was a Gentile. And look what Jesus says, verse number 17. Either Luke 17 says, and Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 clean? But where are the 9? Were there not many of us that God woke up this morning? Were there not many of us that God has brought us through danger, seen and unseen? Were there not many of us that he made a way out of no way? Were there not many of us when the doctor stepped out, he stepped in? Were there not many of us when we were broke, he made a way out of no way and supplied all of our needs? Were there not many of them that when it seemed like life had gave them lemons, that God was so sweet that he turned it around? were there not many of them that could have praised me in the midst of that storm? Because the Bible says, in all things give him praise. And then grace says, there are none found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. I believe that that's the way we are, is that we go to God in need, and he meets our needs, but then we forget, and we're ungrateful. And then look what the text says. Look what the text says. He says, save this stranger. And he says unto him, arise, go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole. Would you look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, God expects your praise. Travel with me just really quick to a text that came to mind that we read this morning. Psalms 34. Psalms 34. Verse number 1. And I'm going to end it on verse number 8. Psalms 34. Verse number 1. Are we there? Look at what he says. Psalms 31. Psalms 31. 34. Psalms 34. Verse number 1. Psalms 34. Verse number 1. And he says, I will do what? At all times, and his praises shall continually be in my what? So no matter what I'm going through, I will bless the Lord at all times. So that means that while I'm in this life, going through danger, seen and unseen, I will thank God because he knows how to change my lifestyle, because my blessing of what he's brought me through, because God always shows up. Then it says, my soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. And this is what I like. Oh, this is an invitation. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. So when we exalt his name together, we can experience his glory together. Is there anybody that don't mind exalting his name this morning? Then it says, I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. I called him when I was in the midst of a storm. I called him when it seemed like there was no way out. I called him when it seemed like I didn't know which way to go, but because I called him, he showed up and brought me out. Can I dismantle for just a moment? Because somebody called him with cancer, and he showed up and made a way out of no way. Somebody called him when they lost a loved one and they didn't know how they were going to make it, and he showed up and made a way out of no way. Somebody called him when they lost their mama or their daddy, and God showed up and made a way out of no way. Somebody called him when they got laid off of their job, and he showed up and made a way out of no way. Somebody called them when they were going through foreclosure, and he showed up and made a way out of no way. Has God ever made a way? And then it says, I sought the Lord, and the good thing is, he heard me, and not only did he hear me, but he delivered me. Is there any delivered folks in the house? Then it says, then they looked up and were lightened. So what happened was, I didn't know how I was going to make it, but I called on God. And I looked up, because I can look to the hills from which cometh my help, because all of my help cometh from the Lord. When I looked up, tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, when I looked up, I realized that God had showed up. And it says, and their face were not ashamed. Would you look at your neighbor and give them your happy face? And tell them, I don't know what you're going through today, but if you look up, some of y'all like that happy face because you ain't seen a smile in so long. But tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, when I looked up, he made a way. And then look what he says. And then the poor man cried, and the Lord heard him. Because many of us don't understand that you can be poor in spirit, and when you cry out to God, He hears you and meets you exactly where you're at. Anybody ever had to cry out to God? I don't know about you, but I've had to cry out to God. And I continue to cry out to God for God to show up. And then look what he says. The poor man cried up, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of his trouble. I want to just share with you this morning that you may be in a situation. You may be so entangled in sin, but you can cry out today, and God will show up. You know what the Bible says? If thou confessest our sins, He's faithful, He's just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And you know, because you can cry out to God, He'll show up. And look what the angel, look what it says in verse number 7. And the angel of the Lord, tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, you got angels watching over you. Tell your neighbor, tell your other neighbors, tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I want you to know that you got angels assigned to you to bring you through. You got angels watching over you, because the Bible says in Psalms that He gives His angel charge over you. The Bible lets us know that you got angels watching over you. So while you're trying to work it out, you got angels that's already made a way out of no way. So I'm telling God, send me my angels. Give me my angels to bring me through. Give me my angels to watch over me. And look what it says. Verse number 7 says, the angel of the Lord. I just wish somebody ought to see this for a second. Can you put your spiritual eyes on? Can you look around you? You got angels all around you. You know, the other day when you almost fell asleep in the car, that was an angel that nudged you and woke you up. You know, the other day when you wanted to give up and throw in the towel, and then all of a sudden, that was an angel that told you that everything was going to be all right. You know, the other day when you were worried about your wayward child, and then all of a sudden you began to pray, it was angels that spoke to your child. You know, the other day when you got that bad notice, and then all of a sudden you began to think back over your life, what God had brought you through, it was an angel that touched you with the finger of love that God had dispatched with your name on it. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, angels, angels. And then look what it says, oh, and I'm trying to get to 8, but I need to deal with 7. It says, the angel of the Lord encamped around about them that feared Him and delivered them. And I'm going to end it on 8 like I told you. Oh. This is an invitation. He said, oh. Now that other word is an action word. Taste. Oh, taste and see. Your Bible say that with me? Look what he says. So that means, now watch this. Now, the only person that's drinking right now is me. Oh, taste. Oh, taste. And then for those that he don't think could catch, oh, taste. And then for those that know that he don't want, oh, 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 case. Now watch this. I gave him a one anyway. Oh! I got him a water. Oh! Oh! But look at these kids. Oh, pass them down. Oh! Now don't miss the message. Watch this now. Oh! 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 Look at what he says. Now watch the text. Watch the text. What'd you say?
Oh.
What'd you say?
Oh.
Hey, Coy. What'd he say, Coy?
Oh.
Now look what the text says. Now watch what the text says. He says, now understand this now. Just a while ago when I read it, what I had was consumed up here. So now that I said, oh, have you got any water? What is it? Is it? And look what it says, oh. Taste and see that God, the Lord, is good. And then not only did he say that, now what happened was, is that he allowed me to taste. And then now that he allowed me to taste, anybody taste it yet? And then another way he says, oh, you shouldn't have took what I gave you if you're not ready to do what the other part says. Then it says, blessed is the man that trusted in the Lord. Now, because he says, oh, taste and see. So what am I tasting? I am tasting that the Lord is good. I am tasting that God will make a way out of no way. I'm tasting that God has brought me through dangers seen and unseen. I'm tasting that his mercy endured forever. I'm tasting that he woke me up this morning. I'm tasting that if it had not been for the Lord on my side, then I don't know where I would be. I'm tasting the death, the burial, and the resurrection. I'm tasting the goodness of God because God has brought me, and because he's brought me, I know, because the Bible says, blessed is the man that trusted in him. I shall trust in the Lord and lean not to my own understanding, but in all my ways I shall acknowledge him, because I know that Jesus expects my praise. I praise him because he's the Alpha and the Omega. I praise him because he's the beginning and the end. I praise him because he went to the cross of Calvary and died for your sins and mine. I praise him because he got up on the third day with all power in his hand. And because of that, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually to be in my mouth. Is there any praisers in the house? Is there any praisers in the house that God has brought you through dangers seen and unseen? So what I don't want to do is, I don't want to be like the other nine. I want to be like the one to where when I come into his presence, I can fall down on my face and I can say, Lord, you've been good to me. Lord, I want to thank you. Lord, you made a way out of nowhere. Lord, when it just seemed like there was no way out, you showed up and made a way out of no way. Lord, when you brought me through danger, seen and unseen, so the least I can do is come back and say thank you. Lord, if I don't do anything else, I can thank you because you've been good to me. Because you're the same God yesterday, today, and forevermore. Is there any thankful people in the house? And because when you say thank you, he's a God of more than enough. I like what you've done, Cherie, because you helped me. Just when you think that all your blessings is over, just when you think there's no more, God shows up and he makes ways out of no way, and it brings more to where when it brings more, he shows you that he shall supply all your needs. Because some of you thought you were counted out. Some of you didn't think there was another way out. But just when you were down to your very last, God showed up and made a way out of no way. Anybody need a blessing? Anybody need a blessing? I saw what this little kid done. She says, in her own self, she said, he's passing over and giving to everybody but me. But God likes a childlike faith that'll reach out and say, what about me? Is there anybody here that would say, Lord, what about me? Lord, you keep making ways. You showed up for everybody, but what about me? I need to know, is there anybody here that says, Lord, I need a blessing. What about me? And I got some good news for you. Jesus expects your praise. And because he expects your praise, if you can thank him while you're going through, he will make a way out of no way. Give God a hand, praise. Often say this, and often use people, because I believe that people want to be able to see the manifestation of God. And you may have already heard this, and you may even know this, but I'm giving an invitation. And I'm going to ask Mika to come up here. She said, oh my God, he's always put me on the spot. But she inspires me so much. Because I share this, and I share this all over the world. Mika was probably 9. Mika, just walk with me for a moment. And I started out being Mika's youth minister. When I pick up Mika, she was snotty nose, coming out of the house, one bag of ramen noodles, shoe in one hand, jacket in another hand. She's always anticipating coming to church. Mika was kind of raising herself, going from pillar to post. She was in a house living with a lady that had 8 kids of her own, 6 of her sister's kids, 4 of her other siblings and brothers, and they were in a 3-bedroom house. When I would go pick up Mika now, I didn't know if the line would ever end coming out of those getting on the church bus. But they would all run on out, and they would all get on the bus. And as they would come every Sunday, every Wednesday, they would come. And then not only that, Mika and them had got evicted out of that house. I think he evicted them because they was only supposed to have 6, but there was 27 in the house. And then Mika kept the faith. But Mika went through some challenges. Not only did she go through some challenges, she had to go through challenges with the mom being up and down, with the mom just being not even around. And then not only that, but Mika was determined. Mika was so determined that she was going to make a difference. She says, I know that what I'm going through right now is just a test. Mika comes on up in the 9th grade. I think it was maybe the 9th grade. She called me. And she says, guess what, Reverend? I found out who my dad was. I get to go meet my dad. She said, I never even knew who my dad was. And then she goes and we go meet her dad. She's very happy. But she said, I know I got a better father than that father. I got a father named Jesus that have brought me through danger, seen and unseen. And Mika said, you know what? I'm going to be the first one in my grade, in my family. I'm going to graduate. Mika not only graduated, she graduated top of it with her class. And then she said, you know what, Reverend? I'm going to go to college. And because she was my youth, I was determined to make sure she go to college. So I went over to Oral Roberts. I got her a full scholarship. She came back to me. She said, Reverend, I'm grateful for what you've done, but I want to go to TU. So she decided that she's going to go to TU. She went to TU. She graduated. Not only graduated, bachelor's of nursing. Not only she graduated bachelor's of nursing. And I brought her up here to show you something. When she graduated from her class, she took the test. And she failed that first nursing test. She cried, she snorted, but she sucked it up. And she said, I'm going to take it again. And she would call. She would say, Pastor, please make sure you're praying. I'm going to take the test. She went and took the test. You know what she did? Before she even got the grades back, she was confident. I passed the test. She didn't get the grades yet, but she anticipated a great success because she felt already down on the inside that she passed the test. And because of that, now she's an RN. Huh? Now, I had to ask her something because now understand this. She grew up without a mama or her daddy. But she didn't use it as an excuse. She watched how life took her through danger, seen and unseen. But she didn't use it as an excuse. She held on to the promises that God gave to her. And because of that, she don't mind. And not only that, in her college year, she was named as Miss Black Tosser. Yeah, Miss Black Tosser. Now, somebody probably could have told her that she was never going to make it, never amount to anything, but she was confident in this one thing, that God started in her, he was going to complete. I want to share with you that no matter where you at in life, the same God that I watch work in her life will work in your life. Life don't always give you a golden spoon, but God will always walk you through the challenges that you go through. I'm going to ask you this morning, maybe you're here this morning. Maybe, you're going through a tough time. Just maybe you're on the verge of quitting. Just maybe you want to give up. See, God not only gave her a scholarship to go to TU, but God also made a way to where she was in leadership positions to equip her and equip her for the tasks ahead in this life. And God knows exactly where you're at. God has strategically placed you where you belong in order to give him the praise and glory for what yet arises ahead of you. I'm going to ask you this morning to please stand with me, and just maybe, I'm proud to attach myself to Mika. I'm proud to see what God has done in her life. She helps me to realize, and you know what? Mika would tell you, oh no, she's not perfect. I remember the first time she called me talking about she's trying to drink in the dorms. She said, oh, that's not me. But you know what? She realized it was a test of the enemy. Then she had some knuckleheaded guy that really thought that he was going to marry her. She said, oh, that's not me. That's not me yet. God got a perfect man in place for me. Amen. So she said she's waiting for God to send the right guy. Amen. She's not looking for somebody that ain't working. You got to have a job. You got to have a degree. You got to be going somewhere in life. She said she don't want nobody, no joker just under the tree. She wants somebody that's going to be able to not only take care of her, but be supportive with her. She said, go on then, Reverend. You're right. So no, really, you may be here today, or you may be even out there watching this, and you may be at a crisis in your life. God is able to meet you exactly where you're at. Don't give up. Don't quit. Think back where God has brought you from and praise Him. Come back and give God some praise. If you're here today and you've never accepted Christ, or if you're here today and you've not been grateful, or if you're here today and you got a situation that's too big for you, I invite you to come to the altar. Come and meet Christ. Come back and worship Him. I hope that you would get connected to a church in your area. And I want to say to you today that as your soul prospers, you should be in good health. Let me pray with you if you made this decision to accept Christ as your personal Savior. God, I thank you right now for the viewing audience, for those that may, God, be sitting right there on their couch, that may be sitting in that chair, God, that may have watched this broadcast, and this message has stirred up a gift on the inside of them to allow them to realize, God, that you are God of more than enough. I thank you, God, that you would meet them exactly where they're at to help them get to where you would want them to be. God, I thank you that if they have not confessed you as their Lord and Savior, that if they've done that today, God, that you would continue right now, God, to stir up the gift, God, to draw godly people around them, God, to help them to get to exactly where you want them to be. And God, I give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for this message, that as they receive this message, God, that they will receive your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. If you said that, if you received that prayer and you said that prayer today, and today's your new day, please write me, call me, let me know. I got a free book that I would like to give you. It's a book called Look What God Can Do. It's a book about my personal testimony on where God has brought me from. If you've made that decision today, I'm not asking for any financial contribution. I'm just thankful that you have recognized that your soul shall prosper. Write today, call today. The book is on its way. Thank you.
Thank you for joining our broadcast. We hope this service has been a blessing to you.
If it's been a blessing, you can send your donations to the address listed on your screen. If you would like to order a DVD, you can call the phone number listed at the bottom.
My dad needed hospice. There was all kinds of emotions. Miller Hospice wanted to start care immediately.
It was very hard, but it was a relief knowing that we weren't alone.
They treated him like he was the most important person in the world. They were like angels to our family and a miracle. They carried us through the hard times, and they carried my dad through the hard times. We were able to get through it with their help. Mm-hmm.